Just a few years ago, this county was praised for its outstanding beauty, and it fended off rival bids from Florence and Edinburgh to host a world-famous French sporting event. Find out what that was, and indeed where I am, in just a few moments. Today on our rural property hunt, we're searching for that elusive element that even our buyers can't put their finger on.
I just need to find out what that something is.
I don't know. It's that
je ne sais quoi.
I don't know.
Bless you. Right, OK.
And I'm feeling the pressure as our couple's wish list is rapidly expanding.
Yeah, an extra bedroom. I could use it as a walk-in wardrobe.
Let's go outside.
Come on.
Today, I'm in North Yorkshire, standing on the route of the first stage of the 2014 Tour de France. Now, this particular section represents a real challenge for cyclists as it leads up to the famous Buttertubs Pass, where sections can reach a thigh-burning 20% gradient. Now, this glorious landscape, of course, looked rather different when the tour passed through, with an estimated 1 million spectators lining the roads, cheering on the nearly 200 elite athletes as they made their way from Leeds to Harrogate. And so successful was the British leg of the French competition that it kick-started a new one, the Tour de Yorkshire, that takes place every year in this glorious county. North Yorkshire is the largest county in England, with a coastline bordering the North Sea. Within this region lie two national parks, the dramatic wilderness of the North York Moors and most of the Yorkshire Dales, where fields and pastures are crisscrossed by dry stone walls. Distinctive limestone buildings are prevalent across this county, notably in Midlam, in the heart of the Dales. Overlooking the market town with its cobbled streets are the imposing ruins of Midlam Castle, once the childhood home of King Richard III. Located in the south of the county is one of the finest stately homes in the country. Castle Howard sits within a 1,000-acre estate and was designed by architect John Vanbrugh at the end of the 17th century. The county's rich geology, evident across its diverse landscapes, market towns and pretty villages, combined with its proud heritage, make North Yorkshire a popular option for many aspiring escapees. Like much of the UK, house prices here in North Yorkshire have remained fairly static over the past year. But this area still represents pretty good value for money when you consider that the average price of a detached house here comes in at around £314,000. That's £40,000 below the figure for England. Now, villages and market towns like Moulton, Richmond or Helmsley often get mentioned as best places to live in Britain, due in no small part to their warm, friendly residents and the community spirit, as well as access to beautiful open spaces like this. So it should be no surprise to learn that today's house buyers have their sights set on a move here. Michael and Wendy live in the new town of Newton Aycliffe, County Durham, in a four-bedroom detached property they bought together 30 years ago. Wendy is a retired maths teacher, and Michael, who works as an electronics engineer, will soon be hanging up his lab coat.
We first met at work. She was the female engineer in the labs. Been married now for 31 years.
They've been wanting to move for a while, but until recently, family commitments had prevented them from uprooting.
We've had a bit of a traumatic 6 months, really. We lost Mike's mum and my dad in November, within a week of each other, and then we lost my mum in March. So we've spent a lot of time looking after them over the last sort of 4 or 5 years. It sounds terrible to say, but now that we don't have them there to look after anymore, then it does give us the freedom to be able to go where we want.
They're now looking for a more rural location, better suited to walking their much-loved pets.
Where we used to walk the dogs is now all housing estate. All the fields around us have gone, where we used to walk up and have, you know, such great times with the dogs, and they're just not there anymore. There's housing estate after housing estate going up, and we just want to be a bit more in a village.
They've chosen North Yorkshire after spending many a happy holiday there. And for Michael, there's a personal connection as well.
I'm originally from Scarborough, which is in Yorkshire, so North Yorkshire, and so I know it from when I was younger.
When we go with our friends, there's about six of us and six dogs, and we all go quite regularly, really, and find bed and breakfasts or hotels. And we walk around with the dogs and we're always going, oh, wouldn't it be nice to live there? Oh, wouldn't it be nice to live there?
The energetic couple have a range of activities they wish to pursue. Michael is passionate about golf, whilst Wendy is a bit more vocal about her hobby.
I've always done a bit of singing and amateur dramatics, and at the moment I do a little bit of charity work, mainly old people's homes, and just go and sing and entertain them.
Although they've been happily married for three decades, they are, by their own admission, chalk and cheese.
Wendy's quite sort of active and likes doing things, very impatient of when she wants to do it, she does it.
Michael is very laid back. He takes everything in his stride. Mike just goes along with it most of the time. Occasionally he'll say, no, I don't want to do that, and then I'll go and do it by myself.
But one thing they both agree on is that now is the right time to move.
We're young enough that we can manage a move, but not too old that, you know, that it's going to be a big effort for us, so we can actually get somewhere and hopefully find somewhere that we like and where we're going to stay for the rest of our lives, really.
Michael and Wendy favour properties in the north of the county, so we'll be looking at houses in and around the two national parks. I'm meeting up with them in North Yorkshire to discuss the finer details of their wish list. So welcome both of you to North Yorkshire. This is coming home to you, is it not?
It is, yes, yes. Back to my roots.
But also, congratulations on your retirement.
Oh, thank you, yes, yes.
When was that?
It was last Friday, so...
You don't hang around much, do you?
I don't, no, no.
So talk to me about this new life. You want to start, Wendy?
Well, we'd like to maybe get a house with some land, get some animals.
Animals?
Be a bit like the good life.
OK, what animals are you going to get?
Well, I'd actually have always wanted to have a donkey. Oh, I think they have to come in pairs, but I'd like two donkeys.
Yeah. OK. Yeah. Why donkeys?
I don't know, they just look like they've been abused all their lives, and some of them are so cruelly treated, and it really upsets me, and I think I would love to give two a good life.
So you want to rescue donkeys,
absolutely,
then?
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah. Yes.
Let's talk about the house. Have you got a picture of your ideal house in your mind's eye?
Well, I think it's sort of slightly downsized from what we have, but sort of three bedrooms. Okay. Minimum, probably. Main living accommodation downstairs, bedroom for main bedroom and ensuite downstairs. A couple of receptions,
right,
large
okay.
Kitchen.
Are you prepared to look at a house and maybe rearrange the property to have a downstairs ensuite?
Yeah, if as long as we've got the money to do that, then absolutely.
Brilliant. Yeah. Okay. Are there rooms that you want to use for new hobbies, pastimes, to escape from one another even?
I've already said we need a his television room and a my television room because we like watching different things on the television.
Right. What about styles? Do you like any particular styles?
I don't really mind. I do quite like not so much open plan, but I like larger rooms. I don't like really small rooms.
I heard Michael say he wanted to downsize.
Yeah, but I think what it means is we've got rooms we don't use. The rooms we do use, we want them to be big.
Let's talk about budget. How much you've got to spend on this big adventure of yours?
Up to a maximum of £600,000.
OK. Well, you're in my hands now. We've got three great properties lined up. Let's see what you think, shall we?
Yep. Can't wait.
Come with me.
Right up.
With a budget of £600,000, Wendy and Michael are looking for a country home with large reception rooms, including an open-plan kitchen diner. They'd like a total of three bedrooms with the master downstairs and outside up to 2 acres of land so they can keep animals, including donkeys. Michael would like a garage and they want to be close to a village. We've lined up a fine selection of country properties for Wendy and Michael to view, but I won't be revealing the price of each house until the end of our tours. The final property, the mystery option, will test how far Wendy and Michael are willing to go to fulfil their rural ambitions. For our first property, we're heading to the popular village of Kirby Hill in the north of the county. For amenities, a good option is the larger village of Ravensworth, 1.5 miles away. Centred on a village green with an ancient sycamore tree and surrounded by a number of traditional stone properties, Ravensworth is served by a well-regarded pub and the hall hosts many local events. House 1 is back in Kirby Hill, which also has a pub and a church with Saxon origins. It's situated at the very heart of the community on the village green. All right then, Wendy and Michael, welcome to your new home.
Yeah. Yeah, looks very nice. I always like the traditional stone-built houses. They always look so lovely.
Yeah, Yorkshire stone. The property is mostly 1700, 1750. It's had some further improvements through the times, even as late as Victorian times towards the front of the property. Michael, what's your thoughts?
It's difficult to know what's inside of how the rooms are.
Come with me inside, come on.
This Grade II listed former farmhouse, originally dating to the mid-18th century, retains many character features inside. But the kitchen, just off a central hallway, adds a contemporary flourish.
OK, the all-important first room.
Yeah, very nice. Yeah. It's actually more modern inside than I expected.
Big, open-plan kitchen-diner was the request.
This definitely does that.
It's huge, isn't it?
Yeah, it's lovely.
You do have a little pantry as well.
Oh.
Of course you do. You
really? Yeah.
You've got to have one of them, haven't you?
Yeah.
Put all our homemade jams in.
Oh, now we're talking, really? Yeah. Well, there's a nice veggie patch where you might start getting a bit green-fingered, so preserves, pickles, jams, all that sort of stuff, that becomes part of the equation with this house, maybe. Reception room just through here. Let me show you.
Yeah.
OK, so it feels quite Georgian, does it, with the symmetry of this house? Big kitchen, big reception room.
Yeah, it's a good size. And I actually like square rooms. I think you can do so much more with a square room than with a long room.
Can you both see yourselves sat by the fire in the winter months?
Yeah, there's something not drawing me in as, yes, this is where I would want to be. But as we say with everything, there's compromise. If everything else is perfect, then it wouldn't be a problem.
I just need to find out what that something is. Because if you can't tell me, I can't then show it to you.
I don't know. It's that je ne sais quoi. I don't know.
Bless you. Right, OK. Let's keep looking around. Come with me.
Right, brilliant.
The remaining ground floor accommodation includes a utility room off the kitchen and a study with stripped floorboards, which, along with the neighbouring shower room, could be turned into a downstairs master suite in the future. We're heading upstairs to explore the existing accommodation. There are 4 good-sized bedrooms up here, including 2 guest doubles and a smaller single room. These are served by a 3-piece family bathroom. I'm keen to see what they think of the largest of the bedrooms.
Imagine waking up to that view.
Yeah, it's lovely.
There was a bit of nice sunshine.
We can't have it all.
Yes.
We are in the UK, remember? Yes. This house is advertised as a 5-bedroom house. 4 up here.
Right.
1 downstairs. Right. It's already here. Maybe this becomes the other reception room.
Mm-hmm. Well, yes.
Which has an amazing view and a bit of a study.
Yeah.
That's a thought. Good sized room, and you can get a nice big wardrobe in, which is always useful. But lots of storage. Yeah, an extra bedroom. I could use it as a walk-in wardrobe.
Let's go outside.
One bathroom.
Come on.
With more bedrooms than they asked for, this house really gives them options to reconfigure the accommodation to best suit them in years to come. To the side of the house is a single garage, with plans to build a double garage already approved. Outside, the land to the rear is generous. It includes a patio area, formal lawn section, and a thriving kitchen garden. There's also a paddock providing terrain for donkeys. Altogether, the outside space amounts to around an acre.
Look at that. Beautiful, isn't it?
It is. That is really nice. Yeah, fantastic.
So now, Michael, how much do you think it's on the market for?
I'd say maybe £450,000.
OK. Wendy?
I'd go £520,000.
Much better guess. The asking price for this house is £550,000. I think you were just sort of flaying around in the dark there, weren't you?
I am. I mean, I'm no good at guesses and things. And
but you're pretty close, actually, Wendy. Well, I mean, what do you think about that? I mean, you can get this comfortably within budget, even at the asking price. Mm-hmm.
Yes, and still gives you a bit more money if you want to do anything inside.
Build that double garage?
Yeah.
You've got something in your mind's eye that I've not yet worked out, but I want you to seriously consider this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Start inside, because it's getting wet outside, OK? I'll see you whenever you're finished. Go for it.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Cheers.
£50,000 under budget. On paper, the first property gives Wendy and Michael pretty much everything on their wish list. The listed former farmhouse features a contemporary kitchen and an option for a downstairs bedroom with four existing bedrooms upstairs. There's a garage and 1 acre of land. What's more, the house is located in the heart of a sought-after village.
I assume this is the bedroom. It could be put into a bedroom, yeah. It's pretty small, really, isn't it? I don't think we'd get our bed in here. I think the house is very nice. I like the kitchen and the dining room. My only reservation is that the bedrooms are quite small.
The land at the back, the paddock, looks quite nice. It's probably quite a characterful sort of area of land, and like I say, potentially for the donkeys, if we could get them, it would be there if we could build a little stable for them.
Now then, all done?
Yes.
Inside, and I had a good look at the paddock as well, did you?
Yes, it's definitely got some positives.
Yeah. Hopefully something to think about, Michael, yeah?
Things to think about, yeah.
Perfect. Now, time for something completely different. Come with me.
Wow.
When they move to North Yorkshire, Wendy and Michael are keen to adopt a donkey to live on their land. Wendy, in particular, is passionate about the plight of donkeys, many of whom end up at one of six sanctuaries across the UK. This one, just outside Leeds, was set up in 1969, and today is home to 23 animals, who were either left abandoned or mistreated, before finding shelter and protection thanks to the dedication of people like centre assistant and groom Samantha Hanlon.
I know there's a few donkey sanctuaries around. What does this one do differently?
At our centre here, we have working donkeys, so they work with children and adults with additional needs, or they go to schools and care homes and meet people there.
So do people just find them or just abandon them, I guess, or...?
Some donkeys are found, unfortunately, that are abandoned. And then some are relinquished to us, so their owners recognise that they are no longer able to look after them. Because of the life expectancy of a donkey, they can live up to the age of 50 or plus. So that means that sometimes circumstances change, so people can no longer look after them. So that's how they end up with us.
As well as providing a sanctuary for donkeys, the charity also offers a rehoming scheme, placing certain animals with guardians, providing they have the right conditions, time and commitment to look after them.
We were quite interested in getting donkeys, and I understand that you have to have them in pairs?
Yes, that's correct. Donkeys, they make very noisy neighbours if they're on their own, and they very much like to have the company of their own kind.
Right.
Is it possible to meet some of the donkeys?
Yes, I've got a couple of boys over here, so if you want to follow me, we'll go meet them.
That's
brilliant.
Great.
Yeah,
thanks,
brilliant.
There are a few things that all potential guardians should have before they can rehome donkeys. They need an acre of fenced-in land, an area of hard standing to protect their feet and access to shelter, not forgetting food, bedding and routine healthcare.
I'd like to introduce you to our boys. This is Harry and this one's Harbin.
Oh. So do they get on with other animals?
They do get on with other animals. It's better to introduce them slowly to other animals because sometimes you may find that they might get a bit too playful because they do play quite rough.
Yeah, because, I mean, we've got dogs and I don't know what the cats would think of them, but the dogs, I assume you would introduce them bit by bit.
Yes, make sure, take your time with them and introduce them slowly.
So what sort of things do they eat?
These guys, they're fed on a straw diet, so they have straw in the troughs on the main yard, but they can go out to the field on an evening to have grass. But we advise not too much grass because they do put on weight very easily.
One of the daily tasks involved in looking after donkeys is grooming, and it's important to select the right brush.
So this one is for his body, so I don't know if you want to have a feel. It's quite prickly.
Oh, yeah.
So that's good to get all the mud off their bodies. They also really like this brush. It's called a magic brush, and again, it's very prickly, and it, you know, it's good for itching them as well.
Yeah, yeah.
And then, finally, we have the soft brush, which is good for their face.
As well as keeping their coat shiny, regular grooming is an opportunity to check the donkey's physical health and behaviour.
He's got really hairy legs.
He does, doesn't
he? So lovely and fluffy, aren't they? Lovely.
Wendy already seems smitten. Learning more about how to care for them seems to have brought her one step closer to keeping them in the future.
So are you guys thinking of rehoming a donkey, then?
Yeah.
I think so, after all this.
Absolutely, more so, I think, now. Now we've actually seen them, they're such fantastic, fantastic creatures.
As the day draws to a close, our buyers have a chance to reflect on the lifestyle that awaits them when they move to this area. I'm in North Yorkshire, helping Wendy and Michael from County Durham seek out their dream rural property. Armed with a budget of £600,000, they're looking for a sanctuary for themselves and a donkey or two. Coming up, our mystery house will hopefully ignite some passion.
I want you to become emotional, Michael. Like a modern man.
Hard to do.
I'm going to chip away at that. I'm going to melt you.
And later, I'm bowled over at the simplicity behind one of Yorkshire's most recognisable features.
I've picked a really hard one, haven't I? You just thrown on there with wild abandon.
Just like that, yeah.
Well, we've got a good day's house hunting ahead of us. Later on, we're off to see the mystery house, which I think gives Michael and Wendy pretty much everything they're after. But the challenge could be the property's location. But first up, we're off to see house number two. Let's get going.
For our second offering, we're heading north to the small village of Chopgate in the North York Moors National Park. A 15-minute drive away is Stokesley, a handsome market town made up of attractive Georgian and Victorian properties. The high street is lined with a range of independent shops and places to eat. Back in the much smaller settlement of Chopgate, we find our second property. Surrounded by panoramic views of the North Yorkshire countryside, this next home certainly has a commanding presence.
OK, so the best spot to get our first impressions is here.
That is lovely.
It is.
Yeah.
Gorgeous, isn't it?
That is lovely, yeah.
This is 18th century with some later additions. A lot of people talk about curb appeal.
Yeah.
And this house, I think, has it. Let's go inside.
Right.
They seem impressed by this stunning Grade II listed character property, which has undergone a complete renovation, creating generously sized rooms, which should please Wendy.
OK, so I'm hoping you're going to like this reception room.
Yeah, this is nice. I like the windows on both sides, giving it lots of light, and the open aspect, seeing the view.
Well, it's a cracking view, isn't it?
It's fabulous. Yes. Yeah, that's lovely.
But what they've done here, I think they've sympathetically brought this up to date. That element of modernity, if you like, that you're used to, but also character.
It's nice. I love the radiator.
Yeah.
Lovely.
If you are to go your separate ways within the house, who gets this one?
Oh, me. This is
I hadn't stopped asking the question then, Wendy, and you came through it. Right, OK.
As well as this huge sitting room, there's also a second, smaller reception room currently used as a study, which leads on to the kitchen, a pretty grand space.
Righty-ho, then. A fairly impressive kitchen.
A lovely kitchen. Yes. Really lovely kitchen. Yeah, yeah. Oh, and patio doors out. Love it. Yeah, it's getting better and better. Very nice.
Well, this kitchen was part of a modern extension built in 2008. They extended the property at the back because the Grade II listed status meant they couldn't do any refurbishments and replacements at the front of the property.
Right.
Which has protected its glorious facade and it gives us this amazing room at the back, doesn't it?
Yeah.
It does.
The kitchen benefits from a large utility room. And there's also a boot room at the rear of the property, useful for their dogs after muddy walks. One key feature of this property is a ready-made double bedroom on the ground floor. It comes with its own ensuite shower room and hopefully it's a favourable bonus for our couple.
It's a good size, open aspect, yeah. Nice views to wake up to.
This house is totally future-proof for you now, isn't it?
I mean, I could sleep down here when I get old and decrepit.
Yeah. That's a way away yet, isn't it, mate?
A few years, hopefully.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
That's probably east-facing, so you get the morning sun coming through. Yeah.
How is this house sort of fitting into your desires or what you think you might like?
It's meeting them at the moment.
Is it?
Yeah, absolutely.
The downstairs is, so far, there hasn't been any real negatives on it.
With this ground floor bedroom offering a dedicated space for them, guests could take their pick of three bedrooms on the first floor, including two doubles set out as singles at the moment, and a double currently used as the main bedroom. They're all served by a family bath and shower room. Back downstairs, the kitchen leads out onto a south-facing paddock, and the main garden is slightly uphill from the house with a separate paddock for donkeys. There are two outbuildings. One's a double garage and the other is an old dovecot. This intriguing building is thought to have been constructed in the 1850s by an aspiring stonemasonry apprentice. The whole plot enjoys far-reaching vistas across the North York Moors, which we're stopping to take in. OK, so here we are. Look at these amazing views.
Lovely.
Tremendous.
So you've got a garden here, as you can see, a bit of a kitchen garden here,
yeah.
And the orchard. And then behind this windbreak, a lovely paddock.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
Yeah. Good size.
Decent,
isn't
it?
It's lovely. Yeah, it's got everything.
So could you live here, Michael?
I think I probably could at the moment. My first impressions are, yeah.
Brilliant news.
Yeah.
OK, then, how about guessing the price of this house?
I'm going to go £575,000.
OK. Michael, your turn, sir.
I think sort of maybe about £550,000.
This house is on the market for £549,000.
Wow, hey? That's quite good. That's good.
That's very good, yeah.
An asking price, well within your budget.
Yeah.
I tell you what, have a good look around and I'll catch you later on, OK?
Right, thank you.
See you in a bit.
Thank you.
Well, I'm glad to see the rain hasn't dampened their spirits because this is a great house, inside and out. I think we're really taking a step forward now.
£51,000 under budget, our second option is a characterful Grade 2 listed property that's been impressively renovated and extended. It provides generous living areas, including a downstairs bedroom. There are a further three bedrooms upstairs, and the outside space includes a double garage and a paddock for those potential donkeys.
So this must be the master bedroom. It's a reasonable size.
Decent size. Nice windows.
Yeah, yeah.
Both sides. I think it's really nicely laid out. There's plenty of land, so the donkeys have got some space to roam up and down if they want.
The things that I'd probably have to look into a bit more depth is the fact that the garden has a low wall and there is a busy road going past it. I'd have to see what we could do so that any animals we had, cats or dogs, couldn't get out that way. But yeah, I think this house is really lovely. I think it's got everything that we've asked for, so I really like it.
So, what do we think? Have we a contender on our hands, Wendy and Michael?
I think we have. I think the dogs, cats and donkeys would love it here, just like we would.
Yeah. Oh, and you would as well. Well,
I think so.
The whole family's happy.
Yeah.
Let's keep going, come on.
Right.
So, the mystery house. Worried? Excited? Come on, Wendy, what's going through your mind?
Excited.
Excited?
Yes.
You look excited.
I am. You know, the mystery house is normally something that you wouldn't look at normally, but always seems to turn out so wonderful.
Well,
so,
it does have that. It does have that reputation.
Yeah,
yeah,
so I'm really excited to look at the mystery house.
For our final property, we're heading southwest towards the Yorkshire Dales and to the small village of Lofthouse. The nearest market town is Pateley Bridge, around a 20-minute drive away. Its attractive, long, narrow high street features a range of independent shops and places to eat. It's also one of the points the Tour de Yorkshire cycle race passes through. The mystery property is near the small village of Lofthouse, which features a pub and a Michelin-star restaurant close by. But the house itself is the most rural we've shown Wendy and Michael, set high up on a hill.
Right then, I think the mystery house wins the competition for vista.
Absolutely.
Really is.
Lovely.
Well, you're from this part of the world. I mean, what does it mean to come back to this?
It's almost perfection seeing views like that sort of thing.
I think that's a good word to use, actually. It's spot on. Yeah. Now, we do have a mystery property to look at. Discuss.
Wow. It's like a little gem in the middle of the countryside.
Built a Yorkshire stone dating back to the 1960s, apparently. I think so far we've shown you properties where you've had things pretty much on your doorstep, if you like.
Yeah.
But I wanted to show you a wonderful rural location. The challenge here is, for some people, it could be a bit too rural. You know, you haven't got a shop a walk away. The pub is a yomp away.
Yes.
What do you think about that?
Yeah, being this far out, something we'd have to think about, but you've got to weigh that up with what you get, haven't you, really?
Should we go inside?
Yeah.
Come on.
The spectacular views on offer at our mystery house seem to have our couple half embracing the remote location for the time being. This chalet-style property has undergone remodelling in recent years. Built from traditional stone, it blends in with the Yorkshire landscape. We're starting our tour in the large reception hall, which leads onto the kitchen.
Now, as you would imagine and hope, most of the rooms take advantage of what lies beyond.
Of the view, yeah, what a great view, eh, out your kitchen.
Yeah. Yes. Right. Lovely way to have your breakfast.
Isn't it? This is a modern house. This is the most modern house we've seen so far. A mere, 50-odd years old. But you've still got the character here, that lovely old beam.
No, it's still got character, yeah.
Good, all right. Let's take a look at the living room. Right, well, I don't think I'd ever put the TV on in here.
You wouldn't need to, would you? No, you just stand and stare at that. Yeah, lovely.
It's very homely and livable.
Mm. Want you to become emotional, Michael. Like
hard
a modern
to, hard
man.
To, hard to do.
I'm going to chip away at that. I'm going to melt you. So imagine yourselves living in this house. Can you see yourselves sat around that fire come the winter?
Yes.
Yes.
As well as this cosy sitting room with a view, there's also another reception area on the ground floor, currently used as a gym, a possible TV room for Michael, and next to that, the potential main bedroom.
All right.
You do have bedrooms upstairs, but this is all ground floor living. Everything you're seeing, I think you could just stay all down here.
Yeah, you could. Yeah. You could easily make this into a bedroom if you wanted to.
Especially when you bear in mind there's a family bathroom just the other side of that hallway there.
Yeah.
Good.
This house gives you two separate reception rooms on the ground floor and a ground floor master bedroom with exceptional views.
Yeah, wake up that every morning, eh?
You don't need to get out of bed.
don't
encourage me.
Sorry, I really...
The mystery house has sparked some great reactions so far. Upstairs, there are two existing bedrooms, both of which are doubles. Outside, the gardens have been landscaped to take advantage of the views. And the grounds include an outbuilding used as a garage, along with a former gun room, a legacy from a time when the property is thought to have been a shooting lodge. The back of the plot is bounded by woodland, providing natural shelter from the elements.
Now, all in all, you've apparently got about 1.4 acres total plot size, OK? As regards grazing land, I think you're going to have to lose a bit of the woodland to get some open grazing for any donkeys if you do decide to rescue some.
Yeah.
But in 1.4 acres, I'd like to think you've got some room here somewhere for them.
Yeah.
So with that in mind, who wants to go first at guessing the price? Wendy, what?
I'm going to go for £495,000.
I would have said maybe £475,000.
Right, OK. The asking price for this amazing mystery house is £575,000.
Okay.
Well, you're only £100,000 out there, Michael, but hey, what's 100 grand amongst friends? Go and have a look around the place on your own. Just do me a favour, give this place some serious thought.
Yeah.
It's gorgeous.
See you in a bit.
Right.
Thank you.
Enjoy.
Yeah.
£25,000 below budget, our mystery property would provide Wendy and Michael with practical downstairs living, as there's a potential master on the ground floor besides the two further bedrooms upstairs. This remote hillside house is set in 1.4 acres of land, overlooking the Yorkshire Dales.
Well, I think one thing about the mystery house is the view. It's just tremendous view. Maybe you'd have to have a think again about the donkeys, because I'm not sure where the donkey sanctuary rescue would come in.
It's very light and airy, and obviously the views are absolutely to die for. They are fantastic, like a picture postcard. The main bit that I would have difficulty with is I am the world's worst driver. I hate driving. And in order to get to and from the house, it's quite a long drive to get here.
Well, that's it. That's the mystery house for you.
Oh. Yes.
Was it a challenge?
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yep. Hopefully it's given you something to really think about, and think about it you must. That's it, no more houses. Let's find you somewhere quiet, have a confab, and we'll meet up later. Is that all right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's great. That's
good. Right across North Yorkshire, dry stone walls are woven into the architectural fabric of its farming landscape. They extend from the dales across to the moors, and are a striking feature which has enclosed both land and livestock for hundreds of years. I've come to meet farmer and master wall builder Cliff Bailey to learn about the craft behind how these walls are constructed.
Cliff, good morning, how are you?
Morning. Fine, thank you, how are you, sir?
I'm very, very well. I'm
jolly good.
Just very happy to be up here. It's absolutely good. Gorgeous, isn't it?
It is, yes.
Now,
good.
These amazing dry stone walls, I mean, they're part and parcel of the dales, aren't they?
They are. They're part of the scenery and part of farming.
You look at them and it looks like they've been here forever, doesn't it?
Well, the walls you're looking at today, they've been here for 250 years.
So what makes a good dry stone wall?
It's just the skill of the way they're built. But the technique has been passed down ever since it started.
Right.
And I'm part of the Yorkshire Dry Stone Walling Guild, and our aim is to protect and carry on that skill.
Have you got any projects on the go?
Yes, we've got a project I can take you to. We can have a look at that, and you can actually do some walling.
Perfect. Let's have a go then.
The earliest evidence of dry stone walls in England dates back to the Iron Age, but it wasn't until the Enclosure Acts of the 18th and 19th centuries that the landscape of the Yorkshire Dales was transformed with the creation of wall structures spanning 5,000 miles.
This is a piece we've been working on and going to do a bit of work on.
So where's this stone come from, then?
This will have been cleared off the land. This will be totally land clearance. No man-made stuff in this wall at all. It's all totally natural.
OK, then, so talk me through it. Where should this be going?
Well, they've all got a face, and you look at the one with that's either green or got the algae on it.
Yes.
So that's that one.
OK.
Then just put it on there like that. And it fits.
Yeah, it does fit. What next? Come on.
Well, you need a flat bit, then you've got to prop it up like that.
Oh, OK. Yeah. I mean, I know it's called dry stone wall for a reason, but the one thing you do see an absence of is any kind of bonding at all. I mean, why didn't they use things like mortar, for example? Well,
it just wouldn't be feasible to get the mortar up the hillsides and anywhere and mix it and get water to it to mix it.
You go right up onto the hill, right onto the top of the dales, and you're miles away from anywhere.
And remember, the stone wouldn't be moved far.
I think that's the unique part of this, then, isn't it? This is making use of things that are immediately available and easily used, isn't it?
And if it's going to last for 250 years, why put mortar in it?
That's the one thing that's going to fail, isn't it? This one?
Yeah.
Well, this is, I mean, look at this.
That's not a good stone, but it'll fit.
I've picked a really hard one, haven't I? Go on, then. You've just thrown that on there with wild abandon.
Just like that, yeah.
Although there are no foundations, the strength of these walls comes from placing larger stones at the base and building up with incrementally smaller pieces. The wall is constructed by two people working on each side of the wall, and the cavity between the two sides is filled in with small pebbles.
Oh, look at that!
To ensure the wall doesn't collapse, flat throw stones are laid halfway up bridging the two sides of the structure.
I tell you what, I'd be very happy to while away my time doing this.
One of the problems is it's very weather reliant.
I'll definitely be a fair weather dry stone waller. Don't worry about that, Cliff. How far could a dry stone waller go a day, do you think?
Well, two people would take down and rebuild 5, 6, 7 metres a day.
Wow, that's a lot.
There's a ton of stone in each metre.
Goodness me. Well, I reckon 5 metres a day is probably quite a bit beyond my current skill set, and I'm probably slowing you down, but I've really enjoyed this. Thank you very much, Cliff.
Right, thank you very much. Thank you.
It's exhilarating to see the natural architecture of these old walls being maintained and repaired using the same method as when they were first constructed. But now it's time to find out in which of our three properties Michael and Wendy want to lay their foundations for their new life in the country.
Well, we've seen three fantastic properties here in North Yorkshire. The only issue I have is I cannot guess for the life of me which, if any of the properties, is coming out on top for Wendy and Michael. So let's find out. So, decision time, isn't it? What's the big plan then? Have you come to a decision? Because I've got no idea what's going through your minds.
Yeah, we actually really quite liked house number two.
Right. What is it about house number two that you like so much?
I think all the rooms, they were there for what we wanted. Mm-hmm. And the land was nice. The only disadvantage was the road nearby, but that's something that maybe you can sort out a fencing and to keep things.
Yeah, I mean, some perimeter fencing there. I think you could make it dog and cat friendly. The owners themselves have a cat at the moment, so that's proof of the pudding and all that.
Yeah. We need to just look around the area, make sure it's for us, and assuming the area's got other things that we want, then I think we would definitely have another look at that house.
OK, so run me through. What is the next step? What happens tomorrow morning when you get up?
I guess it'll be just have a look more closely on a map to see exactly where it was and have a look at the villages around, have a look, maybe have a drive out there. With the dogs, they can come with us, see what they think.
Hopefully with the sun out.
Hopefully with the sun out.
Yeah, see it under a different light.
Yeah.
A better one as well. I mean, looking at a house in the rain, it's not a bad idea. You're seeing it's almost at its worst, aren't you?
That's right, yeah, we did.
Well, I wish you all the best of luck. Please let us know what you decide to do in the end, won't you?
Absolutely.
We will, yes.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you.
On reflection, I shouldn't be too surprised that Wendy and Michael chose house number two, because it does sit quite nicely in between property number one and the mystery house. But I also appreciate that they're a long way off making that big decision on whether or not they want to buy it. So I wish them both the very best of luck when they go back there and take a good look around the whole area. And hopefully, well, the sun will be shining when they do. See you next time.
If you'd like to escape to the country in England, Wales, Scotland or Northern Ireland and would like our help, you can apply online at bbc.co.uk/beonashow.